Why the sad face? The dreaded D word and the dreaded P word. Downy mildew and powdery mildew. The two things that a hops grower never wants to see or hear. But today, that's what we're going to talk about. Hey, I'm Max Raphael. I'm glad you could be with us. I'm from Hops World and Hops Brazil. We had the pleasure on our Facebook group of sitting down live and asking Joshua Havill 20 questions about downy mildew, powdery mildew, and hops diseases. Joshua is a PhD student at University of Minnesota. He's published many publications. His main studies are these diseases, and he's very involved in their breeding program to breed novel varieties of hops that will be resistant or possibly immune to these diseases. So we're going to put a link to contact Josh at the end of the live. If you like, please hit like, subscribe to our channel, Hops World, on YouTube, visit us on Facebook, hopsbrazil.com, hopsworld.com, coming soon. Without further ado, here we go. Hi, Josh, can you hear me?
I can. Hi, everyone.
Hello. Welcome, Joshua Havill. We're pleased for you that are just joining here to have Joshua with us tonight. This is our third live in our Facebook group, Hops Brazil. We will post this on our YouTube channel, Hops World, within a few days or so, and I'll edit it down to just English and just Portuguese, so it's a little bit easier to access and go back to. Joshua, for those of you that don't know of him, is a doctorate student at University of Minnesota, and he is, I consider, one of the experts in the world at this point on hops, downy mildew, and powdery mildew. He's published sized many research papers and documents. He's also a big part of the program of the university in their creation of new varieties and novel varieties that are actually hopefully better adapted to fight these hops fungus. So without further ado, I'm going to get right into the questions. It's downy mildew, powdery mildew, and hops funguses. So first question, Josh, how did you actually get interested? I assume you were interested in plants prior to hops.
Yes, yeah. So my kind of major first interest in plants actually originated in cacti and succulent plants.
So then to get interested in growing hops, how did that happen?
So as an undergraduate student, many years ago at this point, I started kind of researching different crops that were being grown here in the state of Minnesota. And at that point, we had Dr. Charlie Rauer had just started a hop breeding program the year before. And so the upper Midwest is widely known for cultivating corn or maize as well as soybean. And I was not necessarily interested in working those crops. I wanted to identify a crop that was maybe a more niche crop and more special, different kind of specialty crop. And with the Renaissance in craft beer, I thought it was a good fit in terms of working in crop that would provide something of interest. And definitely, you know, at the end of the day, you're able to sit back and relax and drink from the fruits of your labor. So
the fringe benefits.
Exactly.
Yeah. I started growing hops to make my beer, basically.
So Joshua, when did you actually get involved in studying hops diseases specifically?
So as I mentioned previously, when I started my undergraduate research in studying hops, and I began communicating with local producers of the crop, I tried to gain an understanding from them what the major issues that they were facing were. And many of the growers that I had connected with and talked to and surveyed during this preliminary work had indicated that diseases, specifically downy mildew at the time, had been kind of a major constraint for them in terms of both producing the crop as well as kind of the issues that arise from having disease in their hop yards with a disease like downy mildew, specifically due to things like crop loss, etc.
Can you give us a little bit of an overview of hops diseases, not just the specific downy mildew and powdery mildew?
Sure. And I should just back up briefly, Max. In the previous question, my work in hop disease started specifically when I entered into the plant pathology graduate program at the University of Minnesota, and that was following my undergraduate work. But the communication with the growers kind of led to the development of that research initially. So, just to set the stage, is that disease work started as a graduate student.
Okay. So you can go forward with an overview of just hops disease.
Yes, so in terms of the various types of diseases that affect hop, there are several bacterial diseases, but they tend to cause less disease or have less impact in crop production. Although there are some important ones like canker, bacterial canker. Other diseases may include virus and viroid diseases. So these would be things like carloviruses, such as American hop latent, and hop mosaic. They are the three major virus pathogens. There are some, as well as apple mosaic virus. There are some devastating viroid diseases. Citrus bark cracking viroid, hop stunt viroid, and hop latent viroid. Those are the three major ones that are known to cause issues in hop production. And of course, there's an array of different fungal diseases that cause issues, which Max has listed on the screen. But kind of the three or four most important ones that we tend to associate with hop production would be powdery and downy mildew, verticillium wilt, and fusarium canker. And all of these different diseases, all of these different diseases can cause various different types of damage to the crop. Mostly either by decreasing vigor or health of the plant throughout the growing season, or reducing crop quality during harvest.
So, Josh, let's get into a little bit of specifics about downy mildew. I know there's this big giant scientific name, of course, that I can never remember. I'm going to post it up here. And then a little bit of history of maybe how it came about or what they think it came about. And then touch on where it exists in the world, and then anything else specific about it.
Right, so the organism that causes the downy mildew disease is Pseudoperanospora humuli. It is an oomycete organism, that is, it's more closely related to plants than it is to fungi or animals. And that distinct difference in the biological makeup of that organism influences how we control it as well. That being said, The first observation of downy mildew affecting hops is first reported in Japan in the early 20th century. And so about early 1900s, and subsequently other production regions began reporting the organism. Slowly appeared to have spread either to different areas, or maybe it existed in those different areas. It just was not recognized as being a distinct disease. And so kind of those early detections in different production areas subsequently led to breeding for resistance to this disease in different breeding programs, such as England and Germany, as well later on when it migrated to the U.S. And subsequently became a major production issue in the United States back in the 1930s. To date, at least, the type of damage that it causes on plant material, plant material can become systemically infected. That is, the organism is living inside of the plant tissue, and that can lead to decreases in vigor and subsequent die-out of that rootstock, and it can affect all phases of growth, which I know we'll talk about in just a moment. But in addition to that, we know that the pathogen is widespread, and it's been reported in the Northern Hemisphere in all production regions, and likely is present in some of the production areas in the Southern Hemisphere as well. Although areas like Australia and New Zealand have done an excellent job of, and South Africa have done excellent jobs at maintaining quarantines to exclude the pathogen from arriving on their soils.
So, Joshua, how do we know, God forbid, we have downy mildew? I did get some pictures. I'll start posting up also.
Sure. So here we see evidence of foliar infection. So we're looking at the top surface of the leaf, and we see these pinpoint lesions. And if we were to flip the leaf over, we can see subsequent sporulation when there are conducive environmental conditions, as presented here. And so this leaf here, all of that black, fuzzy, dark purplish, those are billions of spores that are beginning to sporulate. And then, again, as I mentioned, given conducive conditions, whether it be humidity, rain, low cloud cover, all of these conditions are conducive to subsequent spread, both via water and wind. And so what appears maybe as just a small lesion on a plant initially, that can spread very quickly and develop very quickly, given the proper conditions. And highly susceptible varieties can subsequently become, the rootstock can become infected, and lead to the production of basal spikes, or terminal spikes even, which is shoots that have crawled up, the coir, and subsequently become infected as well. And those, if you're growing or attempting to grow a highly susceptible variety, you can imagine that those infected shoots are not going to lead to productive, a productive yielding bind, therefore limiting your yield, which is why breeding has been important to develop varieties that are tolerant or resistant to this disease. So again, here we just have some pictures. Initial lesions on the viewed from the upper side of the leaf, sporulation on the below side of the leaf, or the bottom side of the leaf, and then these systemically infected shoots that can both produce spores and also also decrease yield.
So you did touch on this a bit, but can you tell us short term and then long term damages of downy mildew?
Sure. So as I indicated previously, once the plant has become infected, that infection can spread systemically within the plant tissue. And so short term, you can see kind of symptoms develop, such as aerial spikes in those early infected shoots, which might lead for them to fall off the string and decrease your yield. But as that infection travels through the rootstock, that can lead to the production of basal spikes, which will allow, again, allow for kind of that spread within a plant, and you know, the production of additional spores to cause infections in new plants. Outside of that, then you would have kind of the leaves that are highly affected by the disease can fall off and therefore decrease water and sugars being produced by the plant, therefore limiting kind of nutritional health of the plant and decreasing the vigor. So again, you know, kind of indirectly impacting yield.
Less photosynthesis.
Yes. As well as, if in a conducive environment during flowering can lead to complete crop loss or potentially just reduced quality depending on the timing of infection. That would be primarily the short-term losses.
Okay, so in the long term?
Right, so a lot of those same issues still apply in the long term in terms of the type of damage that will be caused, but then as a rootstock or a series of rootstocks become infected and the pathogen continues to, or the disease continues to spread within a hop yard, then subsequently you're looking at, you know, potential die out of heavily infected plants, therefore increasing, you know, time and labor associated with replanting in those areas of where there are high infestations of the disease, and just general overall plant decline in vigor as a result of the infection. So slowly creating some sort of yield drag or yield loss on that productivity of that hop yard.
On the same topic, real quick, I had another question here. Is there there's no really like percentage, say, I guess if it's variety specific, and I mean, eventually it could be a whole 100% loss, I assume.
Yes, yes. Outside of direct crop losses, just kind of if you're referring to like the status of the plant's ability to fight off or stave off the infection. Yeah, you know, some plants do very well and other plants do very poorly. And so, you know, within just a matter of one or two seasons, they could be completely killed.
Wow. So can we discuss the cause, how can I get downy mildew, and how's it spread in my farm, and maybe not even my farm, other farms?
Right. So, kind of the two primary ways in which the pathogen can enter your farm is going to be through plant stock and proximity to your neighboring farm or an area that has disease.
When you say proximity, you know, in Brazil, for example, our farm, I don't think there's another farm within at least 20 miles. Do they know a distance that this has traveled? There are areas in Brazil where there are plenty of farms pretty close now, and it's going to get more populated for sure.
Right. So there aren't lots of good estimates about the length at which the spores can travel. There is some recent research that suggests that a recent publication that came out that suggests that spores were identified over the Rocky Mountains.
It's a lost cause.
They took airplanes and flew, traveled a flight path and collected samples from various areas and identified spores traveling over the Rocky Mountains. That doesn't mean that those spores were infective or had the potential to cause disease, but they were there. But definitely, you know, the closer you are to an infected hop yard, the more likely you are to be exposing your plant material or your hop yard to the disease. But what's more likely is to have received infected stock and planted it, because it does take time for the symptoms of the disease to develop. And part of that's likely as the plant grows and develops and gets larger, the disease slowly grows inside of that rootstock until it eventually is capable of exhibiting some of those symptoms that we described earlier.
So can we talk a little bit about how do we manage I feel there's some people cringing right now, and because in Brazil the plants are sprouting and some people are probably realizing that they're in for some problems. So what do we do to manage if we realize we do have downy mildew?
So, you know, as the plants are beginning to emerge, attempting to identify those basal spikes or those systemically infected shoots that are emerging from the ground, that's going to be important. So commonly the practice of crowning is utilized. And so crowning is you're removing generally the top 4 to 5 inches of the crown. That is generally speaking the top of from the base of the plant where the shoots are emerging. Part of that practice is dependent upon whether or not growers have considered the practice of hilling. That is, you're taking and cultivating the soil and placing the soil onto the basal portion of the plant over the crown. Generally, that practice of hilling is accomplished during the growing season, not immediately following crowning itself. But say crowning will help remove those initial basal spikes from the field. You'll have regrowth. Hopefully you'll have regrowth of healthy shoots. And then throughout the season, monitoring, scouting, searching for any signs of disease, but then also taking measures prophylactically to try and apply fungicides that might limit either growth of the fungus, growth of the pathogen that might already be present in the hop yard, or again, applying to keep that new healthy growth protected from any potential incoming spores.
Powdery mildew. So Joshua, how about this big giant scientific name and a little bit history on powdery mildew?
Right. Cheers, by the way, at sipping my water.
Cheers. And my coffee.
So yes, powdery mildew. Powdery mildew is caused by powdery mildew disease is caused by Podocera macularis. And so this is a true fungus. It's an ascomycete, which is not relevant to you, but the way in which we control disease is actually very similar to downy mildew. That being said, podosphore powdery mildew has been around. It's the oldest described hop disease, dating back to recognition of the pathogen or the disease in the 1700s, and was initially described as fen. It's distributed widely in the northern hemisphere. It's not yet been identified as growing in the southern hemisphere, and has been a major cause for concern for hop growers in the northern hemisphere, both in continental Europe and England, as well as here in North America.
Well, some bad news, it's in Brazil. So yeah, last year, my one friend, I think he received some plants from Germany and took out his whole hop yard. He had 50 or 60 plants. He actually tore them out and started over. So whether it's everywhere, I haven't heard as much as far as downy, but definitely it at least arrived once. I don't know if it's under control. So there's apparently when I went out to Hopsteiner, I think they told me that there are different types of powdery mildew in different regions of the world. And that I'm curious, assuming that powdery mildew is in Brazil, what type and what we need to think about to preventing other types.
Right. So both powdery and downy mildew are obligate parasites, and they're host specific. That is, to date, at least, they've only been described as infecting a small number of hosts outside of hop. So downy mildew of grapes, you know, is not going to affect your hops, and downy mildew of hops is not going to affect grapes. Very similar to powdery mildew. So powdery mildew of hop, to date, has only been described as affecting hop, Japanese hop, and cannabis or hemp. This is the same species, Podocera macularis, but I believe you know, more what you're referring to is the fact that powdery mildew exists as two different mating types. That is, you can think of them as very similar to being like boys and girls. In order for babies to be made, you need both types. And so that's when the overwintering spore, or the chasmophysia, is formed. And then that can be dispersed on seeds, debris in the hop field, or can affect the rootstock and grow on the rootstock, and subsequently cause disease in the following season.
So let's talk about how we know powdery mildew when we come across it.
Right. So thanks for the picture, Max. So here we have a leaf of Japanese hop, and we'd see these small milkish white colonies. And unlike downy mildew, where you'll only see that those black spores develop on the underside of the leaf, powdery mildew can affect both sides of the leaf, and it will grow on either the top or bottom leaf surface. It will also grow along all parts of the plant, such as the cones. And that's really what we're concerned about, is the damage that it is cause or will cause to the cones when the disease is present. Previous work has shown that the more disease we see on the leaves, the more disease we're likely to have on the cones when it comes time to harvest. And like downy mildew, the timing at which the cones become infected is extremely important, because there's a very short window of time that the cones are highly susceptible and would potentially suffer a complete crop loss if they became infected.
So I'm assuming cones like this are unusable.
It is possible that cones that are affected by powdery could be used. But because hops are often during the period of selection for different lots, there are, you know, kind of the aesthetic qualities of the hop. And so the more brown or the more diseased looking the crop is, the less likely you are to be able to sell them, right? So that's kind of, you know, a little bit of disease can go quite a long way in terms of causing losses.
Sure. So what damages can powdery mildew do in the short and then the long term?
Right. So very similar to downy mildew again. You know, the type of damage that we see, you know, with the pathogen growing in the leaf surface and everything, you know, it's possible for the vigor of the plant to be reduced because the fungus is sucking nutrients and in everything that it needs away from the plant, thereby limiting the growth of the plant, and thereby indirectly limiting the yield because of the decrease in plant growth. We also have the cone infection, which is the primary concern. And so if cones become infected early on, you're going to have substantial loss. Whereas if the cones did live on while they're maturing, it's far less of a concern. And those would be examples of kind of a short-term issues. Again, a lot of that is going to be variety dependent.
We actually started the long-term effects of the damages of powdery mildew.
Right. So again, you know, part of it is going to be variety dependent. But in relation to the long-term effects specifically, this is kind of where downy mildew and powdery mildew diverge, because a lot of times the levels at which, say you have the presence of a single mating type, or say you have only boys in your field, right? Which isn't what we want, but that infection is persisting from season to season by infecting those crown buds that form at the base of the plant. And so they produce flag shoots, which perpetuate the disease from season to season. But when you have both mating types, or when you have both boys and girls, then you have those chasmothecia form. You also are creating diversity in the pathogen, and kind of allowing the pathogen to evolve around, you know, potential resistance held by a variety in your hop field. So an example is, you know, Nugget is known to possess resistance to a small number of strains of powdery mildew. But if the strain that causes issues or that causes disease on Nugget were to escape from the Pacific Northwest into, say, the Midwest or Minnesota, and it were to form chasmothecia, you know, in addition to being able to overcome the resistance already present in Nugget, it could, you know, kind of change things up and begin to evolve resistance around other varieties that might have resistance right now. And so it really kind of depends on what's present in your hop yard in terms of how you approach management to the disease, because whether you have one or two mating types in your field is going to matter.
So is it possible that they're both are in Brazil? Assuming my one friend had powdery mildew.
It is possible. So powdery mildew, as it's outside of the plant tissues, but it can kind of be present on, say, like rhizomes on the outer scales of the bud tissue. And so while those infections are relatively infrequent, it could have been that if he imported infected plant material, that he only imported, say, a single strain of the pathogen. But as you begin kind of mixing and matching where you source your plant material from, whether it's, you know, live plants that have become infected with the pathogen, or you're, you know, importing rhizomes, again, kind of clean plant material, and sourcing plant material from a consistently clean source is going to be important.
So can you explain a little bit the causes and the spread of powdery mildew?
Sure. So we kind of touched on that already, but a lot of times sourcing of clean plant material is kind of the primary mode of excluding it from getting into the hop yard, you know. But if once it's in the hop yard again, kind of the major cause for concern is whether or not you have one or both mating types, or, you know, and if you have one, then you don't have formation of that overwintering spore, and therefore it's just being propagated similar to those basal spikes where you have those flag shoots that begin to develop early in the season and then spread the pathogen that way. Whereas if you have both mating types and you know, then you can have things like sanitation matter, because then you have to remove all of that infested crop debris that is potentially harboring those spores that have overwintered. You know, in so then, yeah, it's a lot of work. And then, you know, once you have, you know, the pathogen in the hop yard, it's spreading in a very similar manner, right? Where you have spores growing in the fungus growing in the leaf, producing spores that are spreading to nearby plants. You know, it's a very, very, very similar. You're using things like fungicides and resistant or tolerant varieties to try and control the disease within a hop yard as well.
Assuming we have powdery mildew, what are the management procedures that we can take to try to keep it at bay?
Right. So, you know, the first line of defense, if you have powdery mildew in your hop yard, is to make an attempt to grow or cultivate resistant varieties and outside of being able to grow or have the availability of resistant varieties, then again, it's going to come down to utilizing cultural practices in combination with agricultural chemicals. And we can discuss those a little bit further in a moment.
Okay, so can you explain the cultural practices that we can do?
Yeah, so again, crowning is going to be one potential cultural practice. Again, you would want to do that early in the season when you begin to see growth that's affected, whether it be by downy or powdery. And then, you know, outside of that, trying to limit the conduciveness of the environment. And much like downy, this would include things like stripping the basal leaves. And so you would be taking and removing all of the plant growth in the bottom, say, 3 to 4 feet of the plant. Generally, again, this practice isn't something that is accomplished until the plants have grown to be of appreciable height, you know, maybe in the range of 8 to 10 feet before you begin this process of stripping all of that growth. Because again, what you're doing is when you're removing those leaves, you're reducing the amount of material that can produce photosynthates, and you know, you're potentially limiting the ability of the plant to grow because there's less leaf area to produce the sugars and everything that will be used by the plant to continue to grow. And then combining, you know, those practices with the use of chemicals and different fungicides.
This is a big thing in Brazil. It seems more relevant than in the United States. They seem to have more of a conscience in general. Although it may be, I suspect part of it is there's a lot of new farmers, and I found farmers that have been farming for years are more inclined to use chemicals and convinced that they don't harm the environment as much. But in Brazil, most of us are new. Most of the people growing hops still, I think, are just new farmers. So now the real farmers are getting involved in the bigger the scenario. But can you touch on the difference of organic and non-organic management, if there is such a thing as non-organic for these two diseases?
Right. So, if we're considering traditional production where use of conventional pesticides would be your non-organic production system versus organic, where, again, either one of these production systems, you still have agricultural chemicals. It's just the type and the amount of those types of agricultural chemicals has changed. So commonly in organic hop production, in organic crop production in general, the types of chemistries you have tend to fall within a small number of modes of action or and target, a very small number of specific ways of controlling the pathogen. But then you also tend to have very few of those types of chemistries just in general. A good example is something like Regalia, which is a biofungicide. It's derived from extract of Japanese knotweed, but it has it is efficacious in or has action towards both downy and powdery mildews. So organic fungicides tend to be something that some more often they're broad spectrum in that they control multiple pests or multiple pathogens. But oftentimes we also see that they tend to be less effective in the overall control. That is, you find that you have to apply them more often and you have to apply larger amounts. Copper itself, there are organic formulations as well as non-organic formulations or conventional formulations. But copper has its own adverse effects. If you're going out and continuously applying copper, that copper can build up in the soil and cause issues with nutrient uptake in your hop yard. So I understand that it's, sometimes a matter of philosophy, but with an already limited toolkit to control diseases, by selecting organic production, you further limit the tools that are available to you to control these diseases.
I hear you. I would throw a bomb on spider mites if it would help. But it's become I wouldn't say an argument in the groups in Brazil, but definitely a point of contention amongst the hops growers. I made it to the last question. Even though we dropped twice, and I think the sound went out once or twice, but the big question: have you been to Brazil? And when are you going to Brazil, my friend?
So I haven't been to Brazil. Unfortunately. But I think once the pandemic subsides, we can probably talk about potential trip and coming to see what's happened in Brazil in terms of building the craft beer and kind of the development of hops in Brazil. I'd be super excited. I am super excited, and I'd love to come see the operations you guys have down there.
Cool. Well, you're definitely invited whenever you want. And I spoke to this before, but this year got put on hold, but we plan on definitely doing some events in the future, and you're going to be on our top of the list for a speaker. And we'll bring you down there on our dime if we can make it happen. Okay.
Well, excellent. I appreciate the invitation, Max. And I would guess if in-person event to be held in the near future that there will be far less audio or video drops that come about.
Yeah, for sure. And probably a better translator too. Portuguese is still so-so. So I'm going to open this up to questions. There's a few already in here that I'll start reading and then let people ask as we go here. We have a question here from Patrick Sarnagasan. I should know his name. He's a good friend of mine. I never called him by his last name. So he says, is downy mildew, can it spread in the soil or only in the air?
So this is a question that has bothered many pathologists, many plant pathologists for a number of years. At least at this time, it doesn't appear as though the pathogen is likely spreading in the soil. Most of the spread is likely or bound to occur between adjacent plants that are, you know, if you have, say, a heavily affected plant that is sporulating and spreading spores, whether it be wind or water, etc. You know, that it's been demonstrated that patterns within a hop field, you tend to have heavily affected plants clustering together, which means that there's likely limited spread. But over time, as more and more plants become affected, obviously that spread can occur much more rapidly because you have a higher inoculum load.
So we have a question here, which really isn't a hops disease question, but somebody asked it, and I'll ask you. They want to know what's the best way to combat spider mites, and if they grow in the dirt. It's not really your super expertise, but I'll throw it out.
Spider mites have a very wide host range. You know, they affect all sorts of crops. I know spider mites quite well. I have them in my greenhouse a lot of the time. Spider mites in general can affect a lot of different crops. They tend to overwinter, in crop debris or, you know, on other host plants. And so, they definitely do enjoy eating your hops, and they can cause substantial damage to the cones if they're left uncontrolled. In terms of managing them, again, I don't want to say, I don't want to repeat myself or sound like I'm saying the same thing over and over, but again, it kind of, a lot of times it's going to depend on the variety being grown, kind of various practices that are used to alleviate or reduce issues associated with kind of overall mite levels. And so, using predatory wasp or other beneficial insects to reduce population levels of the mites that are present in your hop yard, as well as use of agricultural chemicals, whether it is organic or non-organic, But again, if you're leaning more towards that philosophy of organic, again, you're reducing the tools that are available in your toolkit to combat those pests.
Yeah, no, in our greenhouse, it's a nonstop spider mite. And we switch products all the time because it seems like we're growing super spider mites. Sometimes I tell my worker that. I say, you use the same thing over and over, they're becoming resistant, and we have new super spider mites. So I think we're good. We spent plenty of time. I really want to thank you, Joshua. And we might think of bringing Joshua back next summer, or depending on, he gets busy that time of year probably. But in the future, think about something specific, a little bit more in depth maybe on each of these two diseases. We definitely plan on having Joshua back to talk about his breeding. I've been reading some of his publications, and it's really interesting since I'm a kind of a hobbyist breeder compared to Joshua, but we do plan on having him back in the future to talk about his genetic breeding program. And his goal is to breed varieties that are very resistant to these all diseases, but especially these two. So Joshua, I thank you very much for your time, for explaining. Sorry for the little bit of problems. I don't know if it was my end or your end, but we got through it.
Yes. Technical difficulties aside, thank you, Max, again for the invitation, and thanks to all of you for attending this evening. And you know, I appreciate being able to come back in the future and continue this discussion, you know, from a different viewpoint.
Sounds good. We'll see you in Brazil.
All right. Sounds great. Thanks, Max.
Take care.
Well, I hope the frown has been turned a little bit upside down. Maybe it cleared up some questions, confusion about these two diseases. The bottom line is that it looks like they are treatable. Organically, it's going to be difficult, but there are definitely cultural practices that can be used. If you listen to Joshua about cleaning the plants, keeping the air in the plants, getting clean plants seems like the number one thing. Buy clean, stay clean. So if you like, please hit like on our channel. Subscribe for next month, every month. Soon we're gonna start putting tips all about hops once a week. Big surprises coming. Thanks again. Cheers to life.